In part two, I left you with the question, was Kermit qualified? I bet you were thinking about Kermit the Frog. Actually, I was referring to a person. Before I discuss the person though, did you know that the name Guanajuato comes from an indigenous language of Central Mexico called Purépecha? Guanajuato is the Mexican state where my mama and papa were born. It's shown in purple or lavender on this map. The meaning of Guanajuato is land of frogs. However, in all the times I've been there, even when I studied there, I've never been so lucky. Studied? Yeah, I went on a study abroad program to learn in and through my Mexican culture. I had to pay for something the U.S. educational system stripped from me when I was a child. That's capitalism for you. Besides Guanajuato, the island of Puerto Rico also is known for its frogs. They're called coqui. El coquito be all up in your face. Seems kind of big, huh? Actually, coquis aren't all that big. Let's take a look. As compared with a dime, for instance, the two frogs in this pic are quite small. Will the for real coqui please stand up? Okay. Will the for real coqui please sing it? Coqui! Coqui! Ki! Ki! So who's the little frog on the right? Is it the male coqui? The male coquis tend to be smaller than the females, but that's not the case here, especially since the males are the ones who sing. The coquis are one of a few frogs who don't need water for reproduction. Ain't that just the most interesting thing ever? I mean, the froglets do as chicks do. They get everything they need in the egg, while birds must keep their egg or eggs warm until it or they hatch. The male coqui must sit on them to keep them moist until they hatch. You know, cause birds and amphibians are different. Amazing. Zing, zing, zing. Just amazing. Have I said how amazing this is? The littler, yes, the littler frog on the right is a different type of frog. Hi, I'm the greenhouse frog. Hi, low froggy. Control of coqui frogs in Hawaii, courtesy of the University of Hawaii at Manoa. According to the university, quote, Hawaii's lush vegetation, warm temperatures, and high humidity not only welcome human visitors, but indiscriminately provide a tropical paradise for the more than 1,000 alien plants, vertebrates, and invertebrates. Alien? Alien like the people from the United States that invaded the islands of Hawaii? That have been accidentally introduced from all corners of the world over the past 65 years. Some have become established at the expense of native species competing for habitat and nutrient sources. End quote. Yeah, it sounds a lot like the people from the US that invaded Hawaii. The university also states, quote, one species. That sounds kind of awkward. The university made a mistake. That has garnered much attention recently is the coqui frog, Eleutherodactylus coqui. Its ability to quickly adapt to Hawaii and its native Puerto Rico and reach unprecedented numbers, the absence of predators, and its noisy mating behavior have made the coqui frog the target of government and community eradication and control efforts. End quote. Quickly adapt to Hawaii from its native Puerto Rico. Okay, Hawaii and Puerto Rico are all islands with tropical weather. Reach unprecedented numbers. Oh, okay, they reproduce. Absence of predators. Seriously? They have no predators? Really? So Hawaii has no birds, snakes, lizards? Tarantulas, hedgehogs, or scorpions and the such? That's kind of hard to believe. It's noisy mating behavior. Trust me, I'd rather hear cookies a million times more than those noisy airplanes and trains around me. Cookies, please rock me to sleep. The cookie frog, the target of government and community eradication and control efforts. Eradication and control efforts? That just sounds so cruel. I mean, how did the little amphibians get from one coast to the other? I'm sure they didn't swim over, you stupid fox. I know that the state of Hawaii has attracted migrant farm laborers from Puerto Rico, so perhaps they traveled with their beloved cookies. I also know that agriculture from Puerto Rico is transported to Hawaii, so perhaps the froggies were stowaways. So on the one hand, Hawaii has benefited greatly from Puerto Rican laborers and agriculture. But on the other hand, it labels part of the island's culture as quote-unquote invasive, which must be quote-unquote controlled. You know, those Puerto Ricans are too loud. They keep people awake at night and run down property values. In this case, Puerto Rican people and their beloved cookie are no different. Is this sounding familiar? So the state of Hawaii controls the cookie population by spraying caffeine. They claim they don't, but please. This caffeine gives them a heart attack. And or by spraying some type of citric acid, which disintegrates them out of existence. Historically, it reminds me of how the U.S. government controlled minority populations by illegally sterilizing women. Do you think that has stopped? Hell no. I'm led to believe that's what some vaccines are for right now. Didn't Hitler sterilize women in concentration camps? Didn't he experiment with humans in all sorts of ways? He sure did. And you say the U.S. is a democracy? What a hypocrisy. According to the university, quote, cookie frogs have a ferocious appetite that puts Hawaii's unique insects and spiders at risk. They can also compete with endemic birds and other native fauna that rely on insects for food, end quote. To this, I have the following to say. Ha ha ha. Have you seen how small they are? Ferocious appetite? LMAO. You're speciesists. Let me explain how you discriminate against the cookie. Okay, let's do a side-by-side comparison on the cookie frog and the greenhouse frog. Both frogs are under the genus Eleutherodactylus. Let's start with the cookie frog in terms of body shape and size. It's slightly less than a half inch long, the adult about 1.5 times larger than the greenhouse frogs. It has a rounder body shape. The greenhouse frog is less than a half inch long and it has a narrower body shape. Okay, so both frogs are different in shape. They're also somewhat different in size. I think we saw this difference in the slide with the dime. Adult cookies are 1.5 larger than adult greenhouse frogs. Let's move to egg clusters. Let's see, the cookie frog egg clusters. In its native Puerto Rico, the female cookie frog usually lays a cluster or a clutch of 34 to 75 eggs 4 to 6 times a year. However, under laboratory conditions in Hawaii, mating pairs produce a clutch every 2.5 weeks without loss of fertility. That's 26 clutches a year, or more than 1,400 eggs per female per year. It takes about 8 months for froglets to mature. Adult cookie frogs may live as long as 4 to 6 years. Okay. The greenhouse frog. Clutch sizes vary between 3 and 26 eggs in Florida. Let's read between the lines on how the University of Hawaii at Manoa has criminalized the cookie. Yes, I said criminalized because that's what it is. In its native Puerto Rico. So this means in its natural environment and under natural conditions. In its native Puerto Rico, the female cookie frog usually lays a cluster or clutch of 34 to 75 eggs 4 to 6 times a year. Now let's do some math. Let's multiply vertically. 34 eggs times 4 times a year equals 136. Now let's multiply 75 eggs times 6 times a year. That comes to 450 eggs. So in its natural environment, under natural conditions, a coqui lays about 136 to 450 eggs a year. So this means under natural conditions, right? Under laboratory conditions in Hawaii. Let's take a look at that now. Reading on the right side, according to the University of Hawaii, a coqui produces a clutch every 2.5 weeks. There are 52 weeks in a year, so how many clutches do coquis produce in a year? After some math, I don't get 26 clutches. Do you? According to the University of Hawaii, the coqui produces 1,400 eggs per year. They're missing something here. What's their value for number of eggs per clutch? Did they pull it out of their ass? Artificial conditions can never compare to natural conditions. Never. Ever. Moreover, nowhere on their website does the University of Hawaii at Manoa indicate what the clutch size for the greenhouse frogs are. Nowhere. Why not? I found the following information on Wikipedia.org on the greenhouse frog, but it isn't complete either. I couldn't find the clutch size anywhere. I guess I have to do some homework. However, I did find out that the greenhouse frog is native to Cuba, the Bahamas, and the Cayman Islands. According to IUCN redlist.org and reading in the middle of the screen, the greenhouse frog is native to the Bahamas, Cayman Islands, and Cuba. It was introduced in Guam, Jamaica, and the United States. And, as it turns out, Hawaii is one of those states. So actually, as it turns out, the coqui and the greenhouse are both alien species to the islands of Hawaii. And it's not just the coqui, since the greenhouse frog was introduced on Hawaii. And how can we be so sure that the one that is overproducing is the coqui and not the greenhouse? If it turns out to be the greenhouse, then whose fault would that be? Should we blame Cuba? I guess the embargo didn't include the frogs, huh? I'm sure it didn't include a lot of other things too, this illusionary embargo. Without a clear picture by the University of Hawaii, there's only one conclusion. The state of Hawaii is speciesist. Stop the genocide of coqui. Back to Kermit. Actually, now to my discussion of the person. This is Kermit. Kermit Tyler, that is. Who is he? According to the WashingtonPost.com in an article published February 27, 2010, quote, Mr. Tyler was the Army Air Force's first lieutenant on temporary duty at Fort Shafter's Radar Information Center on the morning of December 7, 1941, when a radar operator on the northern tip of the island reported that he and another private were seeing an unusually large blip on their radar screen, indicating a large number of aircraft about 132 miles away and fast approaching. Don't worry about it, Tyler told the radar operator, thinking it was a flight of US B-17 bombers that was due in from the mainland. Instead, the bleep on the radar screen was the first wave of more than 180 Japanese fighters, torpedo bombers, dive bombers, and horizontal bombers, whose surprise attack on Pearl Harbor on the island's main airfields shortly before 8 a.m. plunged the United States into World War II, end quote. Unbeknownst to him, Kermit Tyler became the United States government's scapegoat to plunge the country into World War II. Kermit was a scapegoat Why? How?
Hold on to your bootstraps.
December 4, 2006, Pearl Harbor attack. As part of a commemoration of the 65th anniversary of the attack on Pearl Harbor, Daniel Martinez talked extensively about the topic, hidden images, rare and forgotten views of the Pearl Harbor attack. He used photographs taken before, during, and after the December 4, 1941 Pearl Harbor attack as a source for understanding the attack. Harry Butowski talked about early warnings, radar contact at Opana. He described the radar operators learning of the impending attack. He was joined at the event by Kermit Tyler, who was a young lieutenant from Wheeler Field who happened to be assigned to the information center at Fort Shafter on that morning. It was on his watch that the radar station at Opana notified him of unidentified planes coming in from the north towards Oahu. Mr. Tyler provided his interpretation of those events and talked about the controversy that still surrounds them that moment. They were also joined by historian Paul Stilwell and George McDonald, the son of Pearl Harbor survivor and radar operator Joseph McDonald. As a historian for the National Park Service in Washington, D.C., Mr. Butowski headed up the program for National Historic Landmarks and was instrumental in conferring that designation to the Opana radar site. The C-SPAN production lasted over an hour and a half. I will focus on Kermit Tyler's presentation at minute 49 with 23 seconds to 56 with 22 seconds. Kermit's account of the event spanned about 7 minutes. I have transcribed his account on DOCX and have numbered the lines. I have omitted hesitations and most repetitions to maintain the flow of the narrative. There are a total of 44 lines. On the following slides, I provide segments of Kermit's narrative. After a segment, I immediately follow with a slide containing that same segment on the left side and my commentary on the right side. I do digress from this structure a bit, as I usually do. And I must also inform you that all of this will make most sense if you've watched my latest production on World War II. This is for you, Kermit, and all other scapegoats out there. December 7th, 1941, the day that Pearl Harbor was attacked by the Japanese. World War II had been in effect since 1939. So keep in mind, a war is already taking place on this date. Segment 1, lines 1 through 6. I was a pilot in 78th Pursuit Squadron just before Pearl Harbor. I was a number of 15 or so pilots who were taken down to the information center to be trained as, to be oriented as to how the information center would work. At that time, radar was, even the word radar was secret. The capability of this SCR-270 radar that was assigned and installed was about 135 miles. The first time I was assigned to this duty as pursuit officer was the Wednesday before the attack on Pearl Harbor. Okay, so there's a war already going on. During this time, the government decides to install a new SCR-270 radar system at Fort Shafter. Then on December 5, 1941, the military has Kermit, an Army fighter pilot, to man the airplane tracking center, which included understanding the radar. December 7, 1941 was only Kermit's second day at the center. Well, in fact, Kermit had only spent a few hours at the center 2 days prior to December 7th. Segment 2, lines 6 through 13. So I reported down and found out there was no one there by the telephone operator, so I called Major Berkowitz, who was the operations officer who was setting up this whole system, and he said, "Well, I regret to tell you, but there's nothing you can do except if we have a lost airplane. We might be able to tell where it is." It's kind of a weak answer. Anyhow, our next assignment was Saturday noon, but late in the morning on Saturday, I received information that I should come in on Sunday at 4 o'clock. So I accepted this. So Kermit had only spent a few hours at the center on December 5th, and then there was no one there to train him. Major Berkowitz, who was the person in Kermit's words, quote, setting up the whole system, end quote, had given him, quote, a weak answer, end quote, in regards to no one being there to train him. So was Berkowitz ever reprimanded? Well, I'm sure he was only following orders. He reminds me of Edwin P. Wilson, who worked for the Central Intelligence Agency of the United States, the CIA. According to Wikipedia.org, Ed, quote, was a former CIA and U.S. Naval Intelligence officer who was convicted in 1983 of illegally selling weapons to Libya. It was later found that the United States Department of Justice and the CIA had covered up evidence in the case. Wilson's convictions were overturned in 2003, and he was freed the following year. End quote. Ed was selling weapons to Libya with consent of the U.S. Department of Justice and the CIA. Otherwise, why would there be a need to cover up evidence? So like Kermit, Ed was a scapegoat too, and both were eventually absolved from any wrongdoing. Unlike Kermit, Ed amassed millions of dollars of personal wealth while working for the CIA and after he retired as a result. Ed knew exactly what he was doing, but didn't expect the government that he worked for to pull the plug on him. This would be the major difference between him and Kermit. Now, why would the Reagan administration provide weapons to Muammar Gaddafi, a person who Ronald Reagan labeled as, quote, the mad dog of the Middle East, end quote? Well, because as of 2010, now I'm not sure what the digits were back in the 1980s, but as of 2010, Libya has 77 years of oil reserves. You know, black gold. Colonizing countries be wanting the gold. Muammar Gaddafi called Ronald Reagan a quote-unquote terrorist. And well, Muammar, I agree with you. It was also during this time that the Reagan administration provided Afghanistan with weapons, weapons that the U.S. purchased from Israel. Mind you, this is in the 1980s. It was also during this time that the Reagan administration provided many Latin American countries with weapons. Not only that, the U.S. provided their militaries with training at what used to be the U.S. Army School of the Americas, or what is now known as the Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation. The Guardians by Ana Castillo. I read this book not too long ago, and I had to write down this quote that I'm going to share with you now because it's so relevant. Quote, my book's going to be called The Dirty Wars of Latin America, Building Drug Empires, or something like that. The research goes back to when I thought I'd get a PhD. My thesis was going to be on the School of the Americas. It was a U.S. Army center located at Fort Benning in Columbus, Georgia, that trained more than 60,000 soldiers and police, mostly from Latin America, in counterinsurgency and combat-related skills since 1946. Its graduates became experts in torture, murder, and political repression. Since the word got out on what the School of the Americas was really up to, in 2001, the school officially changed its name to the Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation. After 9/11, the government felt it could justifiably come out of its covert training closet, end quote. And this was said by the character Miguel. What do you think these present students or past alumni do in these Latin American countries with all the counterinsurgency and combat-related skills they learned at the School of the Americas / Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation? It's no different from U.S. personnel. Got Huck, or Quinn, or Jake from the television series Scandal? Okay, let me bring it to reality. Got Timothy McVeigh? Got Terry Nichols? You get my point. Back to my commentary of segment 2. Kermit's next assignment was on Saturday, but then it was changed and he was told to go in on Sunday. the day of the attack instead. You know, they didn't want Kermit learning how to read the radar too quickly, I guess. Whatever he quote-unquote picked up on Friday, perhaps he would forget on Saturday and would be at point zero again that Sunday morning. It just doesn't make sense. Of course not, because it was all planned that way. The C-SPAN production also included George McDonald, the son of Pearl Harbor survivor and radar operator at Opana, Joseph McDonald. Opana also had a radar station. George stated, quote, Lieutenant White, communications officer, requested that they shut down early on Sunday because they had been on alert and they had been working all kinds of hours, and he was trying to give them a rest on Sunday, December 7th, and that's why they shut down at 7 a.m., end quote. This explains why there was only a private working as a telephone operator and an untrained Army pilot at the center when the attack occurred. When George made this comment, Kermit didn't refute it, as Kermit had done previously with one of George's comments. So, to me, it's a valid point. Segment 3, lines 13 through 19. I turned on the radio, and as I was cruising into town, I heard Hawaiian music. Well, this told me one thing for sure. A bomber pilot friend of mine had said that anytime they played music in the middle of the night, the flight of B-17s was coming in. Then nothing happened until a little after 7. One of the enlisted men came up and started working on the drafting board. What were the information people use for recognition as to liaison officers, they're called. Where's my, looks around and someone says, your slide? Yeah, my slide. Before I get to my commentary on this slide, let's summarize the events so far. Exactly how did the government make a goat out of a frog? I needed some comedic relief here. How could they do this? Okay, so we have a government who decided to install a new radar system during a war. A world war, nonetheless, and had assigned a pilot to work the new radar system with no understanding of it and with no specific orders on what he had to do. Kermit had called Major Berkowitz, the person in charge of the system, but Berkowitz basically told Kermit, don't worry about it. In this segment, we learn that playing of music in the middle of the night meant that a flight of B-17s was arriving at the base. When Kermit heard Hawaiian music, he confirmed their arrival from the mainland. Isn't it amazing how these fuckers staged all this? I mean, who's heard such an asinine explanation for playing music in the middle of the night? Were officers on the base supposed to get a hard-on when they knew B-17s were arriving? I mean, I'm getting this picture in my mind of officers waking up, getting out of bed, jumping up and down with joy, and flapping their arms up and down like children finding out Santa Claus left presents for them. It was all staged. I wonder how long it had been since they implemented this cultural practice. The onset of the war in 1939? It wasn't until a little after 7 that someone else arrived and started working on the drafting board. I wonder if that person was beginning his shift or what his purpose was. I say this because the Japanese started attacking Pearl Harbor at 7:55 a.m. Kermit describes the airplane tracking center in the following slide. Segment 4, lines 20 to 29. This is the view of the information center, and the plotters are for the 6 radar stations are shown in position. Actually, there are only 3 there, but normally there would be 6. There were 5 on this particular Sunday. Up in the upper left-hand corner was my position where I could oversee what was going on. Now, as plots come in, piloted on the table, the what you call liaison officers, one from Bomber Command, the civilians, and one from the Navy. However, there were none there on Sunday. Now, this plotter who was, it doesn't show the table, on those 3 black boxes up there, was where there was a drafting table, and he showed 2 plots side by side at a 132 miles north, northeast, 3 degrees east of north, actually. I have no way of telling what they were, so I went back to my station. In this segment, Kermit reveals that there's usually 6 liaison officers at the center, one for each radar station. In line 22, Kermit misspeaks. He says there were 5 liaison officers that day that will live in infamy, but later states in lines 25 and 25 that there were none there that day. If there had been a liaison officer from Bomber Command and one from the Navy, for instance, then there wouldn't be a day that would live in infamy, I think, I hope. Kermit mentions the liaison officer, the plotter who came into the center a little after 7 a.m. and showed him 2 plots side by side, but he didn't know what they were. Of course, Kermit wasn't going to know, because he hadn't been trained. Segment 5, lines 30 to 41. About 7:15, I had a call from Joe Lockhart, one of the radar operators, that he had the biggest plot of planes he'd ever seen. Well, they could have been returning carrier airplanes, but I thought they're most likely they could be the 12 B-17s that I expected in. So on other considerations, with no kind of alert whatsoever except for sabotage. As for having any planes available to get up and investigate, there were none. I mean, at the stage where you don't have any, you can't identify by other means. You have to launch fighters and look them over. Well, there weren't any fighters, so I told them, don't worry about it. Things were then quiet till around 05 after 8. I stepped outside to see, get a little fresh air, and I saw smoke and apparently practice dive bombing, I thought in the direction of Pearl Harbor, which was just 5 miles away, 4 or 5 miles away. Almost immediately, I received a call from Sergeant Starr out in the field that the field was under attack, I think. The only thing I have to comment on this segment is how Kermit Tyler was in fact a problem solver. He definitely had offered more than what Major Berkowitz had given him earlier that previous Wednesday. Segment 6, lines 41 to 44. Well, I stayed on duty there for 36 hours off and on, and it was a week before they really got organized. Major Berkowitz was asked how long it took, and that's why he testified with the congressional people. I think we should open the, or you're next, aren't you? Ends his narrative abruptly and looks uncomfortable. Kermit Tyler wasn't disciplined for what happened. In an article published by the Washington Post, February 27, 2010, Kermit said, quote, "I wake up at night sometimes and think about it," Mr. Tyler said in a 2000 interview with the Star Ledger of Newark, New Jersey. "But I don't feel guilty. I did all I could that morning," end quote. For someone who claimed that he didn't feel guilty and that he thought he did everything he could that morning, the events still weighed on him. Kermit abruptly ended his narrative with C-SPAN, looking very uncomfortable. Dear Kermit, thank you for your service. As you've been told time and time again, the attack on Pearl Harbor wasn't your fault. You were a scapegoat. I think it's time for history to be officially corrected in more ways than one. You and your family deserve a very public apology, even if it's posthumously for you. Irma. And speaking of history, in U.S. versus Montgomery County Board of Education 1969, the Supreme Court affirmed District Judge Johnson's order for, quote, faculty and staff desegregation and provided that the school board must move toward a goal whereby in each school the ratio of white to African American faculty members is substantially the same as it is throughout the system, end quote. Okay, so this leads me to reality number 2. In Chicago, the racial demographics are 40% quote-unquote Hispanic or Latina-Latino, 40% Black, and 20% White. So if I've understood U.S. versus Montgomery County Board of Education 1969 correctly, and given the demographics of the city of Chicago, shouldn't schools be reflective of these demographics for teachers? At Curie High School, it seems that instead of 40%, there's only about 20% Spanish surname teachers. I haven't researched all the teachers at the other 10 high schools, but I can safely assume that non-Hispanic and non-black principals, and there were 7 of them, right? Hire white teachers. Don't get me wrong. When white teachers are hired, it should be to assure that they fulfill 20% of the city's demographics. It becomes problematic, as I've indicated with Curie High School, when white teachers comprise the majority of the teachers. This is what Rita Stasi, yes, as in the East German secret police, I'm serious, that was her last name, and yes, she behaved like a member of the East German secret police. She was the former principal at Corkery Elementary School, who, as soon as she became principal, began replacing bilingual Latina teachers with white teachers. I guess when she had me released from my teaching position, she had done it with that in mind. Back in January of 2015, I researched all state superintendents of education for each state and found the following information. Out of 50 state superintendents of education, 41, yes, 41 were white and only 9 of them were minorities. In Illinois, Superintendent Christopher Koch was replaced by Tony Smith. A white man replaced a white man. What's worse is how I've discovered that Tony Smith has never in his life obtained a teaching or administrative credential and has never, ever, ever taught a class in his life. Before arriving to Illinois, he worked for the San Francisco Unified School District and Emory Unified School District. And he was also the superintendent of the Oakland Public Schools. Are you kidding me? What a fucking abomination. Abomination. To better meet their needs? LMFAO. The Chicago Board of Education, October 2015. Let's check out who these people are. Yeah, because I only recognize 2 of them from the board that was in place back several months in April. So let's check out who they are, their education, and their experience in public education K-12. Chief Executive Officer Forrest Claypool, according to Wikipedia.org, education, bachelor's degree, Southern Illinois University, Juris Doctorate from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, experience in public K-12 education? 0. How am I not qualified? Let me count the ways. Forrest Claypool has held high-ranking positions with the Chicago Park District, with the Cook County Board, and after failed attempts at to become the president at Cook County Board and the assessor for the county, Rahm Emanuel hired him to work at the Chicago Transit Authority. And then he became the chief of staff to the mayor of Chicago. And he is now the CEO of Chicago Public Schools. Goodness, he's been the bitch for machine politicians in Chicago, hasn't he? Now he's the CEO of CPS, a lawyer with no education and experience in public education K-12. Wow. Well, this explains why a special senior advisor has been hired for him. Because his ass is unqualified. So let's check out who this special senior advisor to the CEO is. Okay, so the special senior advisor to CEO is Denise Little. According to the Chicago Public Schools website, her following profile includes education, MA from Roosevelt University, quote, has received extensive training through both the Kellogg School of Management at Northwestern University and Harvard University's Public Education Leadership Program, end quote. Experience in public K-12 education, quote, she has held teaching and administrative positions in 5 CPS schools, end quote. She's also been, quote unquote, the chief of networks. Okay, so since she's the advisor to Forrest Claypool, since, you know, he's clueless and he needs someone who's qualified, let's check out how qualified she really is by looking at her credentials. to the Illinois State Board of Education. Okay, so she obtained a general administrative and general supervisory endorsement from Illinois-RU, indicated in the second to the last column. Is that Rockford University or Rasmussen University? Was it an online program? Was it an alternative program? Who knows? Anyway, this was back in 1992, and then 10 years later, in 2002, she obtained her elementary education self-contained general education endorsement from kindergarten through grade 9. But look at the second to the last column again. It doesn't indicate what educational entity granted it to her. And it's also backwards. Before individuals can be school administrators, they first have to teach. Yes, I know that I sound like a broken record, which simply points to a general theme in this broken educational system. Then look at how Denise doesn't have a secondary education grade 6 through grade 12 endorsement. She only has it up to grade 9, so she's missing 3 grades from the high school level. Now, someone who is the special senior advisor to an unqualified Forrest Claypool, the CEO, isn't endorsed in grade 6 through 12? Again, this is assuming she's endorsed in K through 9th even. Well, no wonder the information on the CPS website is so vague about her teaching experience. Let's check out that slide again. Reading the underlined again. Quote, she has held teaching and administrative positions in 5 CPS schools. End quote. Her LinkedIn account that I've checked out as well doesn't mention any teaching experience either. Interesting. Very interesting. Now, let's go ahead and check out the chief education officer and see what her credentials look like. Chief Education Officer Janice K. Jackson. According to LinkedIn.com, her education, Bachelor of Arts, BA, Secondary Education in Teaching and History, Chicago State University. Master's Education, Chicago State University. Master's Leadership and Administration, University of Illinois at Chicago. Doctor of Education, EDD, Policy Studies in Educational Leadership, University of Illinois at Chicago. Experience in public K-12 education, CPS Social Studies Teacher, 1999-2004. CPS High School Principal, 2004-2014. CPS Chief of Schools Network 9, 2014-2015. CPS CEO, 2015. Present. Sounds good, huh? Well, let's check out exactly how good her credentials are at ISBE, the Illinois State Board of Education. Okay, let's see what we have here. None of Janice's endorsements were her major or majors at Chicago State University. This is according to ISBE. Now, how is that possible if she indicates on LinkedIn that her BA is in secondary education and teaching and history? She, like almost everyone, obtained her secondary education grade 6 through grade 12 on July 2013. Again, how is that possible? I know, I sound like a broken record. Look at how Janice just obtained her superintendent endorsement in the very last row. She obtained it in May of 2015. No, hold up. It says that she didn't obtain the endorsement. The third to the last column says N-O for no. Now, why would it say no? What a fucking mess. Yeah, little baby, I'm with you on that one. What a fucking mess. Let's take a look at the president of the Chicago Board of Education, Frank M. Clark. According to the CPS website, education, bachelor's, and juris doctor from DePaul University. So, he's a lawyer. Experience in public K-12 education, 0. Vice President, Jesse Ruiz. According to the CPS website, education, bachelor's degree in economics from the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign and a JD from the University of Chicago.
So he's knowledge in economics and the law. Experience in public K-12 education? Zero. Let's start looking at the members. The first one, Mark F. Furlong. According to the CPS website, education, Bachelor's of Science degree in accounting from Southern Illinois University. He's an accountant. Experience in public K-12 education? Zero. The second member, Mahalia Hines. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. According to the CPS website, education, bachelor's degree from Central State University, master's degree from Northeastern University, doctorate from the University of Illinois. Okay, which one and what are the specifics of each degree? Experience in public K-12 education. According to the website, teacher for 20 years and principal in Chicago or the Chicagoland area, 15 years. Member Dominique Jordan Turner, education, BA in Business Administration from Clark Atlanta University, MBA from Marquette University. Experience in public K-12 education, zero. Member Gail D. Ward, education unknown, experience in public K-12 education. Quote, Ms. Ward has been a teacher and a principal at the elementary and high school levels in a distinguished 30-year career at Chicago Public Schools, end quote. This was according to the Chicago Public Schools website, and it was through the Illinois State Board of Ed that I found out that she attended, so it seems, Loyola University. So it seems that Gail has been a guidance counselor. And well, as I've mentioned previously, counselors at CPS don't counsel students and much less teach them. What they do is administer everything related to standardized testing. As such, I wouldn't say Gail has been a teacher. Nope. Look at how ISBE, the Illinois State Board of Education, has indicated that she obtained her guidance endorsement in 1988 from Loyola University, it seems. And then again in 2013. So, which one is it? Gail was issued, supposedly, right, an elementary education self-contained general education endorsement. When? That famous 2013. Then look how ISBE has also doubled her general administrative and general supervisory endorsements. What a mess, but a purposeful one, I bet. I can safely conclude that Gail has been more an administrator with CPS. And actually, that's how CPS represents her. According to the CPS website, Gail was the founding principal at Walter Payton College Prep, a selective enrollment high school. She was there for 7 years and she improved student testing performance. Walter Payton, may you rest in peace. You had a wonderful, beautiful smile. I will have to investigate how one gets cancer of the liver. I wonder if your environment had anything to do with it. I'll investigate in my next section. Back to the slide. According to the website, Gail also won an award in 99, and then she increased the testing results for special education needs students. I discuss special ed in my next section. So, yeah, November 2006, she expanded her partnerships with universities and foundations, streamlined the eligibility process for new hires. So, is CPS basically telling universities and foundations what to teach or what? Because that would be backwards. Universities, for instance, are conducting the research that CPS or school districts should be implementing. Let's see, blah, blah, blah. So, I'm led to the question. You know, Gail went to Loyola, a Jesuit university. Does the university expect alumni like her to do as Jesuit priests? Well, maybe we should ask the Reverend. Member, Reverend Michael J. Garanzini Society of Jesus. A priest on the Chicago Board of Education? To be continued.
Oh, this is gonna get more interesting.